Today, we are here to discuss the key skills required in answers writing, basically questions related to Indian economy. I welcome you all on behalf of Unique Academy to be part of this lecture. Before I start with the skill sets which are required for answers writing, we'll first of all discuss the syllabus for GS paper 3, the key inputs which are required in each topics of GS paper 3. Then we'll also be having a stock of what is India's macroeconomic scene and how the data related to macroeconomic variables need to be used in answers writing. We will be having a glance at important economic variables, or rather I'll say drivers of Indian economic growth. So there are certain important sectors, there are certain economic activity, no doubt, which is for the last so many years are driving India's GDP growth. There will be certain sectors which have not performed the way it should. We'll also be having a stock of the situation, and thereafter we will be discussing what is required for a good answer writing, and then I'll be discussing with you the set of questions which was being asked in Unique test series. Thus overall emphasizing on the key inputs required. Dear students, most of the time the students are confused about what to write and what not to write, what to refer, what not to refer in GS paper 3, largely related to Indian economy. The importance of current affairs, the application of current affairs, the application of data, the application of key provisions of various schemes, programs of Government of India. So altogether, we need to focus upon how these inputs in the form of data, in the form of set of information, in the form of various provisions of the government schemes and programs need to be used in answers writing. So before I start with that, I think all of you are very much familiar with the syllabus of GS paper 3, and that's too particularly related to Indian economy. Now if you see the syllabus, the larger part of the syllabus is from, is related to agriculture and its various issues. Larger emphasis is on agriculture sector, the farm sector, while there are other things also which need to be taken care of, and the first and foremost is in the topic inclusiveness or inclusive growth and issues arising from it. Now let me discuss with you how you will be visualizing, how you will be analyzing all these topics one by one, briefly giving you inputs about all these topics. If you happen to see this slide, then I have written, jot down some topics which are important for important part of your syllabus. Now, talking about inclusiveness, how you need to create a framework. Now, when you are talking about inclusive growth, you need to be very much clear with what do you mean by inclusiveness. The topic itself is a broad-based. Under it, each and every aspect of Indian economy will come. You cannot ignore a single aspect. Whether you consider a region, whether you consider a caste, whether you consider a religion, whether you consider a gender, whether you consider you, whether you consider me. I mean, the topic is such broad-based that under the sun and sky, each and every component of that can be directly or indirectly related to inclusiveness. So we need to very much clear, very much specific about what does this topic means and what should be its framework, the extent to which this topic can be, can be applied. What is the nature and scope of inclusiveness? What does inclusiveness mean to a rural population? What does inclusiveness mean to farmers? What does inclusiveness mean to urban poor class? What does inclusiveness mean to people from northeastern states? What does inclusiveness mean to women in the society? What does inclusiveness mean to transgenders? What does inclusiveness mean to physically handicapped, old age persons? The domain of the topic, the contents, the overall framework can be extended in such a way that UPSC can ask from anywhere. So in simple terms, you have been told at Unique Academy that inclusiveness has three broader contexts, can be applied in three broader ways. One is social inclusion, political inclusion, financial inclusion. And when all these three will combine together, that will lead to economic growth. Inclusive, that will lead to overall inclusiveness. And when, along with these three components of social, political and financial inclusion, if we could include the environmental sustainability, then that becomes inclusive development. So under social inclusiveness, what can come? How women will be related to it? How a minority population will be related to it? How girls and children, old age in the society will be related to it? How a particular caste will be related to it? The biggest example you can quote of social exclusiveness is that if you try to find the rural areas, you may find certain caste is forced to remain at the outskirts of a village. They cannot participate in day-to-day affairs of the society. So tell me, in a country where we are talking about a higher growth trajectory, when we are talking about competing at the world level, and there we are experiencing that a section of society on account of its caste is forced to remain at the outskirts of a village. Why? The reason is he or she or it belongs to a particular caste. Now tell me, don't you think that is a classic example of social exclusiveness? Women in India are not allowed to participate in day-to-day financial decisions. Don't you think that is also an example of social exclusiveness? Now, we can analyze the social exclusiveness or social inclusiveness by analyzing different examples at your household, at your society, at your village, at your town level, the way women, girls in our society are looked upon. Reasons can be different. But then, this is the state of Indian economy. This is the state of socio-economic conditions of a particular class or a caste. And then, we are saying that we are going to compete with other B countries in the world. Political inclusion, again, you can quote lot many examples. And the biggest example of political exclusiveness, I always tell that why in India, certain class, certain families have been representing the country for several years together. The best example of political inclusiveness, I always say, each one of us has a right to elect and right to be elected as representative. But why? Why such environment is not created? Why a common man cannot represent? Why these have become exceptions to a common man? We need to look at this particular topic from a broader angle, then only we'll be able to do justice with this particular topic. I was again giving you an insight of the topic. I'm not going to touch upon all the dimensions of the topic, but then dear, the only thing which I was pointing you towards was that have a comprehensive view of the topic. Refer good study materials, read journals, read magazines, read newspapers which can give you rational views rather than, extreme views. Now, one question, if it is being asked that India, since last 70, 75 years, have rolled different policies, different programs, but then also we have not attained 100% inclusiveness. Some areas are more developed, some areas are less developed. There are heterogeneity amongst different population, different castes, forget religion. The benefits of GDP has only touched positively on the lives of a small section of the society. The poverty numbers are not going down as it should be. The problems of unemployment remains as it was earlier. The agrarian distress more or less remains same. So tell me, if these problems, these issues which the Indians are facing today, if different policies and programs were rolled by the government, why these issues are not yet resolved? It means there may be certain problems, certain challenges at the execution, at the implementation level. Tell me, if the benefits of GDP growth has only touched the lives of a section of population, then what does GDP growth mean to me? What does GDP growth mean to you? What does GDP growth mean to a farmer? What does GDP growth mean to an unemployed? What does GDP growth to me growth mean to a poor? What does GDP growth mean to a woman who is harassed, sexually exploited? What does GDP growth mean to a section of population who is considered to be backward on account of belonging to a caste or a religion? If the benefits of GDP growth has not touched the lives of millions positively, then the meaning, the GDP growth becomes meaningless. So we need to understand that how this GDP growth can be broad-based. Attaining double-digit growth rate will not resolve the problem of a farmer. Attaining a double-digit growth rate will not resolve the problem of an unemployed, of a farmer, of a poor, unless and until the benefits reaches to him also. So the growth need to be broad-based, and that's what we were trying to attain by inclusiveness. So you need to review different magazines, different articles, have a very comprehensive view about the topic, think on different parameters, direct and indirect relations, as if a question is being asked that why, how bank penetration in rural areas can enhance the scope of inclusiveness. How the government various schemes such as Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, PM Kisan, Ayushman Bharat, how they can enhance the scope of inclusiveness. So you need to be very much clear and about how these topics can be related. And remember one thing, if you are directly relating without justifying the facts in economics, you are merely giving your opinion. And trust me, opinions are, that opinion will be your opinion. You should always try to justify the opinion by the use of data and set of informations. Don't make hypothesis. Or rather, I'll say, don't make only hypothesis. You need to prove the hypothesis also. And how you can prove the hypothesis, how to prove the assumptions? You can prove the hypothesis and assumptions by using of data, by using of set of informations. So overall, it's not only about inclusive growth, any topic which you are taking, you need to have certain data, certain set of information regarding the topic. Make notes, jot down first of all the topics which are given as a part of main syllabus, and write certain data related to it also. And try to mug up the data, try to get the data from authentic sources. Don't blindly copy the data from any source. So all these definitely will help you in getting marks in GS paper 3. See, if you will not be using data, if you will not be using set of information from the government bulletins, from the government sources, from the government institutions' websites, so your justifications, your statements may not be justified, and that will be merely your opinion. But when we try to use data, we try to justify our opinion, why it is so. So if I am saying that the benefit of GDP growth rate is not broad-based, so I need to write, in order to support this statement, that poverty level in India is near to 30%. So this way we need to justify the statements which we are quoting. And in economics, it is not desirable, it is highly required. Now, next topic, which let's take, mobilization of resource. Now, when we talk about resource, what does it mean in economics? What does it mean in economics? So, as you have been told in the class, that when we talk about resources, it has a very comprehensive view, it has a very comprehensive meaning. Land as a resource, minerals as a resource, humans as a resource, then comes financial resource. So when we are talking about resource, and that to mobilization of resource, we should not only talk about financial resource. So exploring the topic is very, very important, considering the overall meaning of the meaning of the term. So if we are restricting the meaning of resource to only financial resource, it is only a narrow view, it is only a narrow approach, because resources in economics are not restricted to, financial resource. Human resource is equally important for any economic growth. And that is true in the case of management of land and management of water also as a resource. In the near future, management of water for any country will become one of the key attributes of growth and development. Now the world is filling, even India is filling the pinch. So our policies and programs need to be changed, need to be modified, need to be formulated in such a way that trying on the path of growth and development, we need to take care of land and water also. We need to make optimum utilization of all these resources. So what are the problems in water management? What are the problems in land management? How we can attain optimization in extraction of minerals? What are the different sources of revenue generation for the government of India? How human resources can be converted into human capital? What is the importance of education and health to, education and health in transformation from human resource to human capital? How India can increase its spending in education and health? So, when you start exploring the topic, you get different dimensions, and that's what makes the topics very interesting to you. The more you'll explore the topic, the more you'll be broad basing the concepts, the more you'll find that the topics is directly or indirectly relating one or other economic variables. The more you'll be thinking about it, the more you'll be getting a comprehensive view about the topic. And in the examination, you will having enough of information in attempting any question related to that particular topic. Now, briefly, I should also tell you about how should be your approach towards agriculture sector. Dear, one thing, the one of the most important thing which you should remember in writing answers for economics is that you should not be carried away by a set of ideologies which are not broadly applied, which are not widely considered, which means that you need to have a rational frame of mind. You need to have a thought process which can give authenticity and rationality to the topic when you are writing any question, you are writing any answers pertaining to any issues related to agriculture. Your socio-economic background need not influence your writing skill. What does I mean by it? It means that if I am from AC category and if I happen to write on reservation in jobs, then my views should not be carried away. My views should not be influenced by my social background. I should have a rational view, and that rational view need to be accepted not only by the caste which I belong to, but it should be accepted by the general category, open category or general category students or population also. I'm here, I'm not representing AC, I'm not representing ST, I'm not representing general and open, I'm representing India and India's population, I'm representing Indian economy. Most of the times I have seen that students writing answers related to social issues, related to issues related to agriculture, gets carried away easily if they are from rural background. Your answers should not give a feeling to the concerned individual that you are propagating one agenda while the other view you do not know. That is not accepted. So, if you are writing any answers related to agriculture issues, if I am the son of a farmer, if I am AC, if I am ST, if I am from Northeastern population, so my answers should not be influenced by it. Try to restrict. Have a rational view. You are not writing, you are not representing a section, you are representing the whole population. You will be an administrator. Your policies, programs, your thought process should be justified. Now, talking about agriculture issues, see, few of the issues will remain as it is in the next 5 years also, and in the next years, in the coming years down the line, you may find that issue, I mean, not being resolved under Indian agriculture. The issues related to increasing farmers' income will always be there. Issues related to MSP will always be there. Issues related to productivity and rural infrastructure will always be there. Food processing sector will definitely be an emerging sector in the near future. Supply chain management, again, will be very, very important, and that too agriculture subsidies. I mean, these are the few topics, these are the few issues pertaining to agriculture, which you will be finding in the next 10 years also. No government will commit political suicide by removing MSP. No government will commit political suicide by removing agriculture subsidies. So these issues, no doubt, will be there. But then, as a student, when you are writing answers related to agriculture subsidy, when you are writing answers related to MSP, when you are writing answers related to how we can increase the farmers' income, so we need to justify what we are saying. So let's take an example. If I say MSP, what do you mean by MSP, minimum support price? How minimum support price is calculated? Which is the institution which is responsible for calculation of MSP? What are the different methodologies of calculating MSP in India? What is A1? What is A2? What is A2 plus AFL? What is B1, B2, C1, C2, C3? I mean, these are different methodology of calculating MSP. And last part is that to what extent MSP need to be given to the farmers and how much it is beneficial in order to resolve the issues related to the farmers. Next comes whether MSP can be a temporary solution or it will be a permanent solution, because for the last many years it is being carried. So if it would have provided permanent solution, so altogether by now the farmer problems would have been resolved. But since the farmer's problem, the same problem which was persisting in 1960 and 70, persists now, it means MSP may not provide a permanent solution. It can only provide a temporary relief to the farmers. So what can be done? What are the alternatives available? If we continue to increase the MSP, what does WTO compliances say? So we need not get carried away by the emotions as to the farmers are protesting for the last so many days. So your judgment, your justification should not be carried away by all this. Similarly, agriculture marketing. How over a period of time, first of all, you need to understand about what do you mean by agriculture marketing. What is marketed surplus and what is marketable surplus? What is the role of FCI? What is, under what conditions APMC, Mandis or APMC Act was passed in 1960s and 70s? Whether APMC is relevant today or not? Whether there is a need to liberalize Indian agriculture market or not. And then you can correlate the recent farm laws also as to what extent it will liberalize the agriculture market, to what extent it will benefit the farmers. So all these will become part of agriculture marketing. What are the government recent initiatives under agriculture marketing? Your e-nam and all. Talking about supply chain management, you need to be very much clear about what is supply chain management. Right from producer procurement to final consumption at the hands of consumer, each and every activity which involved in between will relate to supply chain management. So, what is the state of supply chain management in India, largely in agriculture sector? What can we do to boost it? How technology can give larger support in boosting supply chain management? So, concluding, I want to tell you that, see, these topics which are given in your syllabus are, that is life of, Indian economy. So, and these topics will be important in the near future also. So, what you should do, I'll tell you, each and every topic, you make one page note. Simply, I'll tell you, one page note of each and every topic which is given with set of data also. You need to write few data, few set of information for each and every topic. And whenever you find any new value addition, whenever you find any new issues related to this particular topic, try to add that new issue under that topic and think how the new issue can be related to this particular topic. And if you can find any articles in the newspaper, try to make or write the summary of that article also and relate to that particular topic. If you do for 1 year, you need not to refer any book or a magazine for preparing for, GS paper 3, largely Indian economy. There is no need to refer. At most, you will have to refer each economic survey, or I'll tell you, your notes will be better than anybody's notes. Again, I'm repeating, for each and every topic, make one page note with few data, few set of informations related to that particular topic. As and when certain new issues comes out, you need to add that issue. You need to relate that issue with a new topic. And if you could find any article related to that particular issue in the newspaper, try to think about the summary. But one precaution which you need to take, I'll tell you, sometimes in articles, I mean, there are political commentators, I mean, giving their economic views. Please, again, don't get carried away by them. Don't exactly copy their views. Use your common sense also. If I belong to XYZ political party, and if I'm writing on an economic issue, trust me, I'll be only giving one side of that particular issue, which benefits me and my political party, whether I belong to XYZ. So when you are writing, when you are reading, referring those articles, I mean, think about those articles to be one side, one dimensions of the topic. Don't completely absorb those dimensions as to this is what it should be. Because when you will be again reading another article on the same topic by another individual who is from another political party writing on economic issues, then you will realize that these are two divergent views. So what we have to do? If justified, we have to absorb the both views. Because we are not going to represent one political party. And that's what will give you rationality in your thought, in your approach. So that's how you need to prepare, dear. And I tell you, if you do it for 1 year thoroughly, you will be getting good marks in essay. You will be getting good marks in GS paper 3. You will be getting good marks, I mean, in interview as well. This is not simple, but this is not difficult also. If you are really serious, if you are really consistent, please go through newspapers, go through magazines, find out if there are any issues, there are views regarding that particular topic or not, and try to take certain points which you find justified. So please write and make a note on that particular, issue, that particular topic also. Now, before I move on to how we need to write answers, I want to discuss you the India's macroeconomic scene and how these can be applied in writing answers. Now, in few of the answers which I have found in the last 15 to 16 years, the students who are very intelligent, very good at writing skills, but then also certain statements made by them, does not seem to be largely feasible. When you are writing any solutions to or any conclusion regarding any topic, give suggestions, give solutions which seems to be feasible. I always tell my student ki agar main ek gareeb aadmi hu, maine aap logo se pucha ki kahin yahan par ek chota restaurant hai kya, ya kahin restaurant hai kya, mujhe bhook lagi hai. So you cannot say me, or you cannot ask me that JW Marriott is beside you, you can go and have your breakfast. This cannot be a feasible solution. I cannot afford to have that. If instead of that, you can ask me that 50 meters down the line, there is a small restaurant where you can get vada pav, so that can be a feasible solution. So when you are writing any solution to any problem, whether in the present context, whether that can be achievable, that can be feasible, or that can be possible or not, that's what you need to think of. As an administrator, if there is a problem of water crisis, and if you happen to ask, then find a solution to it. So rather than taking care of ground situation, you cannot ask to have a direct linkage with Arabian Sea or Bay of Bengal. That cannot be a feasible solution at this particular point of time. Now, why I'm quoting this in context of this present slide is that sometimes students have a habit of writing that India should do like China. India should move ahead of China. Now see the figure. India's share in world's GDP is 3.3%, while China's share in world's GDP is 16.3%. And a quarter of world's GDP is being contributed by USA, if you can see the slide. Now, if I am writing any statement that India should do the magic of crossing China may not be a feasible statement which I should quote at that particular point of time. Yes, I do agree that our steps, we need to take steps so that we can come near to China. We can reduce the gap between India's GDP and China's Chinese GDP. But then it will take years for India to move near to China. And the same policies which are applicable in China may not be feasible in India, because their functioning, their governance, their political system is different, and India's political system is different. And political systems make a huge difference in decision making also. So when you are comparing two economies, you need to understand the background related to it also. Whether that is just your statements are justified or not, you need to think twice or thrice. No need to compare India with China. India need to be compared with India only. Our today need to be compared with yesterday. And we need to have a plan for tomorrow. And that is the best way where we can move. So we need to compare ourselves, we need to compare our growth story with what it was yesterday and what we are trying to achieve in the near future. So see, I want to tell you, and you need to remember this also, because this is one of the data. These data, I'll tell you, will really help you in analyzing. If not, you please do remember these two sets of data while writing answers for GS paper 3. That will give you an edge in getting good marks. Now, see the other side of the story. See, India is the fifth largest economy, and our contribution in the world's GDP is 3.3%. Now, see the other part. See, our per capita means what you have been taught, national income or total GDP upon total population. That's what will give you GDP per capita. So now we need to understand that though our contribution is fifth highest in the world's GDP, but when we think about the overall GDP per capita, it only shows the income level, average income level of an individual. The average income of an individual will further show the average demand of a consumption demand of an individual. And in spite of that, see, the inflation on year-to-year basis in August 2020 was 6.9%. Now compare the inflation in other countries and compare the contraction also, the second quarter contraction. This is second quarter GDP growth. So you please, if you this latest GDP growth and inflation rate was just to show you how India and its growth cannot be compared with others, because there are a lot of gaps. There is other differences in the level of governance, political systems, which does not provide a clear-cut base for comparison. But then one thing is certain, that USA is contributing to 1/4 of world's GDP, China 16%, and India 3.3%. Now see the difference between India and China share in world's GDP, 5 times ahead. So overall, any such statement as India should consider Chinese growth an example need not to be written. We can quote, we can take their best practices, we can take their best investment models, but then we need also to understand that their best practices, their best investment models, whether that can be applied in present set of, political systems in India or not. Because that will largely define the overall growth rate and growth prospects. So this is one important part. The other important part about India's macroeconomic scene, I want to give you one important data which you need to remember always and every time. And the data is, let's see, in 1920, India GDP at constant price was 203.39 lakh crore Indian rupees. I'm again repeating, you can see this slide. In India GDP at constant price in 2019-20 was 203.39 Indian rupees lakh crore. Out of this India GDP, let's see, rural GDP contribute to 50% of India GDP. Now tell me that 50% of GDP contribution comes from rural economy. And rural economy does not only consist of agriculture sector, rural economy also consists of non-farm, non-agriculture sector such as manufacturing and services as well. So we need to understand that the importance of rural economy, and this year during the current crisis where our GDP growth was contracting, the major silver lining came from rural economy only. So there is an urgent need to have a review about different sectors operating in rural economy, rural India, and policies need to be framed in order to support those sectors pertaining to rural areas. whether it's manufacturing, whether it's construction, whether it's service sector, and no doubt agriculture being important. Now, here see, agriculture contribution to GDP in overall India GDP is only 16%. Now, don't you think near about 50% of India GDP is contributed by rural GDP? And under, if you see the agriculture contribution to overall GDP, it's 16%. So now tell me, when rural GDP contributes to 50% of India GDP, and agriculture within rural GDP only contributes 60% of to India GDP, it means larger contribution in rural economy comes from manufacturing and services. Now you need to be very much clear about the contribution of rural GDP to Indian economy, contribution of agriculture to overall GDP. Now one thing is clear, that non-farm sector along with agriculture becomes the major driver of rural economy and Indian economy as well. So don't have an assumption that when we talk about rural economy, larger thrust is on agriculture. The data is showing that in smooth functioning of rural economy, non-farm sectors are also major contributors. And if I happen to tell you that during COVID times, when other sectors were contracting, your manufacturing was contracting, your services contract, but then we could find 3.4% growth rate in agriculture. So the strategy in driving India's economic growth need not be framed overlooking agriculture and other sectors pertaining to rural economy. So when we talk about different policies, as I was discussing about MSP, supply chain management. Now see, if we could boost infrastructure, creating robust supply chain management, that will not only support the rural economy, but that will increase the pace of agriculture growth also. So increasing agriculture growth, that will also influence manufacturing and service sector, because trying to boost our supply chain management, supply chain networks, value chains, creating value chains. Now the other part, interesting, I tell you, if you happen to write any answers related to rural economy, you need to very much clear about what are the government interventions, and you need to jot down in a piece of paper, and that you can do on a very continuous basis also. So you need to write on the paper rural sector, rural India, urban India, government intervention, government interventions in agriculture, government policies in FMCG, government policies in FMCD, government policies related to automobile, government policies related to banking, government policies related to service sector, manufacturing. So all these initiatives in a piece of paper, when you maintain, that what are the government intervention in agriculture, what are the government intervention in FMCG sector, what are the government interventions in the FMCG sector, what are the government initiative in banking sector. So on a piece of paper, write a summary of it. I'll tell you an example how you can have enough of information or data related to mains exam. Take it seriously. I am focusing upon how government initiatives have influenced agriculture sector. So I know one important point, that the government is committed to double the farmer's income by 2022. Government has announced MSP, increased the MSP price. Government has introduced Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana. Government has introduced PM Kishan. Government recently has introduced three farm laws. So these can be interventions in agriculture. Let's take, if I'm taking about taking interventions in banking sector. So government has already introduced Jan Dhan Yojana. Government has also introduced direct benefit transfer. Government has also introduced, RuPay cards, Kisan credit cards. So these are certain initiatives in the banking sector for rural development. Other rural development initiatives can be your increased spending in MNREGA, your Deen Dayal Upadhyay rural skill development scheme. Then there is again Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, will also add to it. Then there is electrification of all the villages, Pradhan Mantri Ujwala Yojana. So all these initiatives you need to write pertaining to pertaining to each and every sector. And write down for each sectors, making different compartments. So once I'll write government initiatives in rural area, another I'll write government interventions in urban area, then I'll write government intervention in banking sector in rural area, government intervention in banking sector in urban area, government interventions for poverty elevations, government intervention for unemployment elevation, and make a chart of it. I tell you, 50% of the contents which you need to have, 50% of set of information which you should have for writing mains answers can be resolved by it only. If you do it like this on a continuous basis, along with, I told you, one page notes of each and every topic along with the current developments, tell me what UPSC will ask beyond this. So please do that. If you do have any problem, if you find any query related to it, dear students, I at Unique Academy, to my students, I have never said no to any student when they have sent me any answer for evaluation. There is no any single student who can say that his or her query is not resolved when they have approached me. You are most welcome regarding any query, regarding any doubt pertaining to this. But I tell you, whatever points I emphasize, please stick to it. Make notes the way I have told you. The government initiatives, government interventions, make a chart of it in a big paper. Paste it on the wall where you sleep, where you study. go through it, revise it, I mean, regularly on a continuous basis. Add to any issue, add to any policy of government of India. And trust me, over a period of time, you will have a lot of information. And trust me, you can develop your answer writing skill like anything. So that's all for, the basic background which you need to have in writing answers. Next, we'll be discussing the 10 questions which have been given to you for a discussion. And based on these only, I'll be discussing those questions also as to what was expected from you. The first question, I think all of you must be having those questions. Please, read each and every component of that question first of all. So I read it for you and I want you all to read it. Breaking the question into different components so that you can relate each and every component of the question and we can justify each and every component, because each and every component will have certain, marks, in the total marks with the question which you can secure in that particular answer or question. Now the question was, the uproar over farm related bills is merely a political exercise rather than economic. Critically examine the statement in context of bills related to agriculture market and contract farming. Now please underline farm related bills. Please underline farm related bills, then underline political exercise, then underline economic, and then two important bills I have mentioned here related to agriculture market and contract farming. This is a 10 mark question. Now pay attention. The first part or the first sentence of the answer should be about the recent bills. So the three bills, or even if you quote two bills, that then you will be justifying. Now, is a political exercise rather than economic. What does this mean? That political uproar which is taking place, the strikes and lockouts which is taking place, whether that is a political exercise or an economic exercise, that you need to justify. So again, I am repeating, the uproar over farm related bills is merely a political exercise rather than economic. Critically examine the statement in context of bills related to agri market and contract farming. Now, why it's a political exercise and why it's an economic? See, and we are talking about uproar over farm related bills. See, the rational thinking should be, it's both a political as well as an economic, though both will have different magnitudes. The precautions which you need to take in writing such answers is that you cannot directly hit the farmers because they do have a right to protest. They need to be clarified. They need to be convinced, because we do have parliamentary democracy. So uproar can be there, criticisms regarding any policy should be there, but remember, I am always of the belief that there should be responsible criticism. And that's why I always say that I always prefer to criticize rather than criticize. So we, in a democracy, we do have a right. So no doubt the farmers will protest, we will protest, but then the government need to clarify our doubts. Now, what should be the approach of yours in writing this answer? What is the economic basis? What is the political basis? Both need to be justified. Now, as I told you, that when we talk about the overall three bills, the three bills are directly related to liberalizing the agriculture market. Whether liberalization of Indian market is necessary or not, that you need to justify. Giving few points. APMC should be there. MSP should be there or not, also need to be justified. Now, I tell you the context. See, when APMC Act and APMC Mandis were set up in 1960s, so there, the motive behind setting up of Commission Mandis were different. And the reason why those Mandis were set up, because the farmers were unaware about what should be the correct price of their produce. Being residing in villages with no connectivity, they were always at the mercy of middlemen, and most of the times, without knowing the price, they used to sell at very, very less price to the middlemen. So in order to secure better pricing for their produce, the government introduced commission mandate where they can get a fair price of their produce. But over a period of time, there is complete change in the needs and requirements of the economy. Before 1991, the base of the economy, the economic system was different. Now, the change, the needs, requirements are different for the economy. We need to compete with the other countries also. We need to create infrastructure in rural areas also. We have to boost supply chain management also. And without private sector intervention, these things cannot take place. Whatever you say, if that would have taken place, then after 70 years, there is again my question, why it has not been solved? We know that the government does not have that much financial resource in order to invest in all the sectors of the economy. Regulation of that will become very, very difficult. So when there are certain reforms which is liberalizing the agriculture market, which is giving free hand to the farmers to decide to act, no doubt need to be taken seriously. See, one thing those who are talking about small and marginal farmers, see, small and marginal farmers were not benefited during APMC days also, and will not be helped during, during liberalized set of market also. And the reasons are very simple. The small and marginal farmers, they do not produce too much. Most of their produce is directly used for their consumption only. They are burdened with so many debts, so they will definitely go for distressed sale, whatever you do. So whether pre-liberalization or whether after liberalization of agriculture market, that is not going to change the existing, economic background of small and marginal farmers. So those who are saying that this will impact the small and marginal farmers, you know the ground story, you know the ground reality. Today also, small and marginal farmers are at the mercy of middlemen. The middleman has certain social contacts with those small and marginal farmers. There is trust also between them. So definitely, they feel very easy to do transactions with them. So middlemen are going to exist today also. These big corporates, whatever you may say, will not lend to a village to deal with agriculture farmers. Either they'll be dealing with farmer produce organizations, or they will be dealing with the individual farmers through a middleman only, wherein that middleman will representing that particular company. So 100% elimination of middleman is not going to happen. The middleman will be there also, but here this time they'll be acting as a company or corporate representative who has been given the task of dealing with the small farmers or set of farmers. Because a big company like ITC, big company like Patanjali are not going to directly deal with the small farmer. Either they'll be dealing with farmer produce organizations, or they'll be dealing with set of farmers through their individual, agents or executives. But see what the benefit will be. See, when you liberalize the market now, so you ease the laws, you ease the regulations. The now, whether small farmers or big farmers, they will have a free hand whether to sell here or there. And as far as atrocities on small farmers is concerned, trust me, now Ayodhya issue has been resolved. Now Kashmir issue to larger extent has been resolved. No government will do a political suicide by not taking care of the farmers, whether X or Y or B, any political party. The next important point is that when private sector's intervention will take place, the supply chain management and rural infrastructure creation will become fast, because there will be no deficiency of capital. So overall, we do have the economic benefits of farm related bills seems to be many. No doubt there are few issues which need to be resolved also. And number one, the issue is that whether government will eliminate the MSP or not? See, I tell you, tell me, as I told you in the beginning also, in the next 10 years, no government can touch MSP and agricultural subsidy. Because that will be like, ki aa bail mujhe maar. That will be a political suicide for them. So this is really, I mean, no government will do such suicides. They cannot do. So even if there is a suspicion amongst farmers in a democratic country like India, the government need to approach to them, try to convince them, try to come out with certain solution, and if possible, the government can come out with a written assurance also, where it says that MSP is not going to be eliminated. So overall, the larger benefits are seen in these farm related bills, which you need to justify the essence of neoliberalism. Always is beneficial, and I found that farmer prosperity is can be attained, their income can be doubled, not only by deregulations or not only by liberalization, but along with it, government need to come out with sound macroeconomic policy and governance. So when the government, along with these liberalized measures, will have sound macroeconomic policy and governance, so these three things definitely will help in attainment of farmer prosperity, and that's how you need to conclude it. So, am I right? Any question, dear? That's what I'm telling you, Pawan, Aki. I mean, why government is not giving? See, trust me, I'll tell you what is the issue there. If the government can give in writing now, that will give a message to the private investors. You would also need to understand that to what extent you can increase the MSP. Increasing the MSP to a larger extent will, voiding the WTO compliances also. Remember one thing. We are not only governed by Indian policies in terms of international trade, we are also governed by certain international laws compliances. So one thing is that there are WTO issues. The other thing is that will not give a strong message to, the private sector, because they are the final investors. And that's why this is somewhat worrying government. But even though when the crisis is prolonged for too long, government need to come out with this. There is nothing called, as far as private investors are concerned, even if the government gives in writing, if private investors see that there is demand in the rural market, there I can make profit, so definitely they'll go for it. But then there is a larger chances that private sectors may be reluctant in that case in order to invest. The next question was, The global economy is much headed towards protectionism. I'm again repeating, the global economy is much headed towards protectionism now as compared to 2008-09 crisis. Is protectionism so sustainable in the long run, and how can global economy be reshaped to make it more inclusive and broad-based? There are three components in this particular question. I mean, you need to give equal importance to all these three parts. Number one, much headed towards protectionism, no doubt. If you go by the years from 2000, so 2000 to 2005 was the years wherein countries were advocating globalization. Most of the countries, most of the policy makers, most of the intellectuals, most of the economists were advocating globalization during those years. But afterwards, the US economy started facing crisis, and then it started the era of protectionism, and which gave a blow to the advocates of globalization. So every country from 2008-09, they started taking measures in order to protect their economy. So largely, the country's self-interest started coming into picture, and each and every country were trying to exports with no motive to import. So a pessimistic trend was set as far as international trade was concerned. In today's era, if you talk about protectionism, there are several examples. America and American first, Trump's policy. The countries manipulating their currency, different countries manipulating their currencies in order to increase their exports. Different countries advocating their exports, countries delinking themselves with a particular trade agreement or economic union like Brexit. This justifies the overall protectionism. See, protectionism was always there. It is not only about 2008-09, it is not only about now. Protectionism was there, is there, and will always be there. Remember, individual economic self-interest will come first. And if at any point of time they find that their individual interests are not sufficed by being with a particular union or regional trade agreement, so they'll definitely like to move out, because any country will like to take care of its individual interest rather than common interest. This is natural. So protectionism was always there. It was, it is, and it will be in the near future also. But then what matters will the degree of protectionism and how far international institutions will be mediating in order to reduce the magnitude of protectionism. See, protectionism may not be sustainable in the long run, because remember, no country is self-sufficient. No country has all the resources what it should have for economic development. So definitely the country need to open their economy, country need to go for international trade, and that's what will lead to global growth recovery. protectionism in the matter of crisis will further slow down the global economy, and directly or indirectly that is going to harm the economy. That is for sure, and that has happened in past also, wherein during times of crisis, when the countries started protectionism policies, that no doubt at the initial stage that benefits their respective countries, but in the long run the slowing global growth starts harming those economies. So protectionism at this particular point of time may help a country on a temporary basis, but that may not be sustainable, because slowing global growth is going to harm particular economies in the long run. Now the third part was, how can global economy be reshaped to make it more inclusive and broad-based? See, as I told you, the question C, how it has been linked to inclusiveness. So here inclusiveness is not pertaining to Indian economy. When we are talking about inclusive growth, inclusive and broad-based growth, we are focusing upon how the benefits of world GDP growth rate can be broad-based, can be inclusive. How can GDP growth rate may be broad-based so that it also touches the lives of millions from African and Asian economies? So what should be done? So number one, we need to engage for international cooperation. We need to go ahead with international trade. Countries need to give assistance to, different poor countries in the form of technology, in the form of, financial resource. The international institutions need to come up, whether it's IMF, whether it's WTO, whether it's World Bank, they can contribute to a larger extent as far as making the world economic growth inclusive and broad-based. Understood, all of you, dear? The third question was, the major challenge for India now is reviving the demand as compared to reviving supply. I'm again repeating, the major challenge for India now is reviving the demand as compared to reviving supply. What are the major roadblocks? What measures, according to you, can revive consumer confidence in India? First, let's target this. The major challenge of India now is reviving the demand as compared to reviving supply. reviving demand rather than reviving supply. See, during pandemic, at one stage, you must have experienced that there was lockdown pertaining to movement of people, and slowly and gradually, the government started opening the small-scale units. See, the question comes from that problem and that policy measures of the government. I'm again repeating, at one point of time, you must have experienced that the government started opening small-scale units, industrial units, while people were forced to remain inside their homes. Now, we need to understand, people locked inside with no income, how and why the private investors will like to invest and produce, for whom they will produce if there is no demand? So, for reviving the economy, reviving the demand is equally important as reviving supply. So, for reviving the economy, we need to take care of reviving demand as well. And the theory says that private investors will always like to invest when they see visualize demand in the market. When the overall Indian consumers were forced to remain inside with no income, on what basis the private investors will like to invest at that particular point of time, even if you give them capital at a zero cost or 0% rate of interest, they will not like to invest because they do not find any demand in the economy. So what should be done? Either you let them move out of their house, let them go and work, or you provide them certain cash incentives in their hands so that they can buy. As in economy, we do have a challenge of this also, because we do not have that much financial resources so that the government can give cash incentives at the hands of all the section of population or all the units of the population. But in spite of that, what you must have seen that as a fiscal stimulus measures, many sections of the society were provided certain cash incentives in their account, whether to certain section of women, to certain section of poor, farmers, to farmers in the form of PM Kisan. So these fiscal stimulus measures in the form of cash transfers to them was one of the fiscal policy measures in reviving demand when private sectors are not reluctant to invest and supply without having an adequate demand in the market. And that's what this government has done. Either with MGNREGA, because when rural wages are with rural wages, there will be increase in demand. So whether it's MGNREGA, whether it's PM Kisan, whether it directly cash transfers to certain section, all these were, a strategic fiscal policy measures by the government in order to, boost demand. Now the next part is that what measures according to you can revive consumer confidence in India? See, remember, as a part of policy measure, when in any economy, at times of crisis like this, when nothing is working in reviving demand, the government expenditure policy or fiscal expansionary policy, where government need to increase its expenditure and reduce its taxes, can only be one of the important measure which will increase or boost consumer confidence. So at a time when overall economy was contracting, no doubt that was a serious situation for Indian economy. So in that situation, in order to ensure, in order to increase consumer confidence, the government expansionary fiscal policy measures can be one of the most important tools in reviving consumer confidence. And apart from it, the other policies related to different sectors, the other policies either with taxation or with relief packages to different sectors, all these will no doubt help in reviving consumer confidence. Now the fourth question is that the development model in India needs to make a paradigm shift towards agriculture sector to ensure inclusive and broad-based growth. Again, the development model in India needs to make a paradigm shift towards agriculture sector to ensure inclusive and broad-based growth Do you agree? Comment. This was the question which was being asked. How agriculture sector can be transformed? How our development model should be centric towards agriculture sector so that our growth can be made inclusive and broad-based. Simple. Nearly 42% of the population, is employed in agriculture. So agriculture can be made employment oriented. Agriculture can be made in such a way that it generates income. It is not led to debt. It does not lead to increasing debt burden for the farmers or those who are employed in agriculture. So what should be done? So the important issues which confronts Indian agriculture, and that we already discussed, the issues related with agriculture marketing, issues related to MSP, issues related to overall rural development, issues related to develop or explore allied sectors, horticulture, dairy, and other sector. So if we try to resolve the basic agriculture issues related with traditional farming system, issues related with cropping pattern, issues related with increasing productivity, issues related with research and innovation in agriculture. So if these issues can be resolved, so definitely, the overall growth can be broad-based. And see, development model in India should always be centric towards agriculture, though we cannot ignore industry and services as well. See, whenever there is growth and development, and you move from one stage of growth and development to another stage of growth and development, so remember, there will be labor migration from agriculture to non-agriculture sector. I'm again repeating, whenever there will be growth and development, so due to growth and development taking place in the economy, labor migration will always take place from agriculture to non-agriculture sector. So in order to ensure broad-based growth, no doubt the development model need to focus on agriculture, but remember, at the same time, industry and services cannot be ignored also, as our economy is, the way our economy is, I'll say that both these three sectors are interrelated. No sectors, can be independent. We cannot rely on one sector. All the sectors balance each other. And I always say that IAS model, industry, agriculture, and services model need to be adopted, wherein agriculture should be the center, but at the same time, like an atom, industry and services need to balance this. And when all the three sectors will be taken care of, then only our growth will be inclusive and broad-based. But then, at the same time, as the question says, agriculture development model in India, need to make a paradigm shift towards agriculture. No doubt, there is a need to, development models need to be concentrated towards agriculture. But at the same time, when we want to attain broad-based and inclusive growth, industries and services need to support each other. Agriculture need to support industry and services. At the same time, industry and services need to support, all the three need to support each other. And that's what I told you. It's like an atom, where agriculture being nucleus and industry services in the form of valence electrons in the outer cell they are moving. So altogether, the forces within these sectors will balance the atom, will balance the economy. And that's why, in order to make inclusive and broad-based growth, these three sectors, I mean, should be taken care of. Now, the principles of cooperative federalism, I mean, would have resolved the labor migrant crisis in India. However, the competitive federalism thwarted it. I mean, that's why that's true. I mean, you can well understand the problem related to labor migrant crisis in India. The way migrant laborers lost their life is serious. I mean, is elation for India and Indian economy, because India as a country was not having data of their migrant laborers also. Such a country, such a huge investment in data, but then, as I always tell, challenges brings opportunity also. So now this crisis brings an opportunity to all of us that at least we need to think of that, what is the data, what is the number related to migrants of labor. And during this crisis, laborers were left at the mercies of their respective home states. That's what is competitive federalism. There was no any concrete steps taken by center and states combined together so that their problems, immediate problems, can be resolved. Their different accidents, different laborers lost their lives in migrating to their respective native places. Some of them die of hunger and starvation also, and some might have died and we do not have a record also. So if there would have been cooperative federalism or principles of cooperative federalism acting, if there would have been cooperation between the states and the center, so definitely these problems of labor migrant crisis would have been resolved to a larger extent. But then somewhere or the other, the competitive federalism or the principle, which govern center states, did not act, and that's why the sufferings were largely, labor migrants. So in India, see, we need to have, in order to have, in order to think on national level, we need to have a database of migrants and the central policy program. Whether it is the laborers are residing in X, Y, Z states, there need to be, proper accommodation for them, or else the government has started with rental accommodation for migrant laborers. That is one of the good initiative, and that's why, this crisis only gave a new opportunity wherein in the near future, the government can come out with affordable housing scheme, though on rent basis, to the labor migrants. And one ration, one card, definitely will help the migrant laborers who are migrating from one part of the state to another to at least get 2 meals in a day, at least get, food grains at subsidized rate, so that to ensure, better life and better livelihood. Now, talking about SDG 3 promotes good health. Next question. The SDG 3, Sustainable Development Goal 3, promotes good health and well-being, critically evaluate the global efforts to achieve this. Does the current global health infrastructure support this? What are the challenges faced by least developed economies? Forget least developed economies and their health infrastructure. We have experienced how the country which contributes to 25% to the world's GDP, how that country has struggled. We compare the health expenditure of that country, the other countries compare their health expenditure with that country, but see, even if they spend a larger percentage of their GDP in the health, but then also this pandemic has shown that is also very, very less. So forget developed countries, forget developing countries or least developed states. I mean, see the existing global health infrastructure, how it crashed in the midst of this particular crisis. So what should be the global efforts? See, I tell you, good health and well-being. I mean, first of all, different countries need to ensure this with their own national income. This cannot happen in a day or two. There are different and numerous problems and challenges a country is facing at their level. They cannot afford to inject all their national income into one challenge or not problem, because one problem is being resolved, one challenge is being resolved, other challenge crops up in any economy. So in India also, we were today struggling with COVID. We have another issue, another challenge of bird flu. If that will resolve, some other challenge, some other problem will come up. So what does we need to do? Slowly and gradually, the best way for any economy to have better health and well-being is to continuously take efforts in order to boost GDP growth, because that increasing GDP growth will give substantial space in terms of financial resource for that country to invest in health and education. So the reason why different countries have struggled is maybe this is an exceptional crisis which we have faced, but in the coming years also, I mean, the problems of health and its infrastructure cannot be resolved by consistently fostering, I mean, economic growth. So the first and foremost requirement for attainment of health, good health and well-being is, I mean, economic growth. The second is preventive health care measures. I mean, most of the time, why we think of post-mortem, why we can not take steps in order to prevent the disease itself. So preventive health care for developing economies and least developed economies are very, very important, because most of the challenges, most of the problems of the economy can be resolved, I mean, if we'll be taking certain preventive health care measures. So the people need to be made aware. People need to be made aware about the importance of preventive health care measures. People need to be made aware the importance of cleanliness. The people need to be made aware of importance of good health and hygienic conditions. So if they are made aware of, if they are convinced about the importance of, a larger part of health related diseases and issues will resolve automatically. Once a country starts attaining better growth, better economic growth, so automatically the government of that country will have a larger set of resources in order to invest or in order to do spendings for, I mean, health and its infrastructure. Apart from it, for developing least developed countries, what is required is that the countries need to go for public-private partnership models. See, in India, if you see the state of health infrastructure in India, and if you analyze some of the government hospitals at the taluka level, at the village level or a small town level, I tell you, the basic problem is not only of doctors and nurses, staff, but the basic problem, basic limitation lies with health infrastructure also. In few of the hospitals, what you could find that there are doctors, but there are no pathological clinics. Pathological facility is not there. Ultrasonography facility is not there. I mean, tools and technology related to, I mean, higher version of diagnostic machines are not there. So rightly, directly, a patient is forced to take care of private medical services. by paying larger price. If the government hospitals can tie up with private bodies wherein services can be provided by the government doctors, nurses, staff, while for diagnostic purpose, pathological checkup, if we can tie up with a private body, so immediate problem can be resolved to a larger extent. So public-private partnership model, no doubt, is very good initiative. And as I told you, in providing better healthcare insurance in case of Ayushman Bharat, don't you think the government has tied up with different private hospitals also? So this is also one of the mode of intervention by the government, where government is trying to provide medical facility to its larger set of population. So this is, I mean, you could have quoted this example that Ayushman Bharat is also a classic example where government has tie up with different private hospitals where government will be refunding the charges for the treatment to the hospital depending upon terms and conditions. And that is also one of the way, this is one of the ways wherein government, public and private sector has come together. So these, I mean, all together, I need not repeat the same 7 questions. It was talking about sustainable healthcare model. So sustainable healthcare models, I'll tell you, I mean, there are certain states like Gujarat, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh. I mean, they have successfully experiments, I mean, with innovative public-private partnership models in healthcare. And definitely that initiative need to be taken by other states also. Now, the one question which I want to, and that will be last question for me to discuss with you all. And that is question number 10. The benefits of minimum support price have been only minimal at larger economic cost. This is the statement. The benefits of minimum support price has been only minimal at larger economic cost. Critically examine the statement. See, when we are talking about minimum support price, see, understand this. What are the economic costs attached to minimum support price? Procurement at a higher price, above the market price, number one. Storage and distribution through PDS at central issue price. It means the government is buying at higher price and then selling at a lower price. One thing. The second important thing is that a storage capacity and distribution capacity. So if you put all these things together, you will find that the benefits which is going to farmers are less than the cost attached to it. Number one, why? That the small and marginal farmers, if you go by the survey of NITI Aayog, I mean, many of the farmers in northeastern states, they do not know even, they are not aware even whether there exists certain kind of MSP or not. Search the awareness level. See, we started with MSP in 1960s, and about 60 to 70 years also, the farmers are not aware about whether there exists MSP or not. The second important point is that a farmer having a small acres of land will not sell its produce, bringing it to near either FCI or designated other agencies, I mean, to sell its produce. Because taking, I mean, produce from rural areas to urban areas or near to the designated agencies requires a lot of effort. It's not that easy. So in that case, I mean, farmers, the small farmers sell to the middleman, and the middleman used to get the benefits because the middleman has a larger collections at the village level where he buys from small farmers and then he sells at MSP in the larger, I mean, designated agencies. So the benefits of these MSP largely accrues to that middleman, that intermediary, or to those big landlords. So see, if the government is procuring, government has introduced procurement of food grains in order to ensure national food security, so no doubt that is good, fine, because we need to have, we do have a larger population, we do have a population below poverty line, so government need to ensure food security, and we do have passed Food Security Act also. But then we need to think to what extent MSP need to be given. What is the cost related to it? What are the different alternatives related to MSP? If MSP, again I am repeating, if MSP would have been successful, then the farmers' problems would have been resolved by then. It means there are other issues which has largely been responsible for farming distress or farmer distress in India. So if we are really serious about resolving the farmer issue, if we are really serious about removing agrarian distress, so we need to bring the structural reforms in agriculture. We need to come out with structural changes in production policy, in marketing policy. We need to come up, we need to create infrastructure, we need to create warehouses, we need to create cold storage, we need to encourage private investments in agriculture or rural infrastructure. Then only we will be able to resolve the agrarian problems or agrarian distress, and that can no doubt increase the income level of the farmer. See, we need to understand, this you can apply to recent farm bills also or current bills. See how the growth takes place, I'll tell you. Whenever private investments take place, let's say it is taking place in rural areas and they are creating some set of, warehouses and cold storage. Now, see, when they are setting up their cold storage and warehouses, this itself will create set of employment in that particular area. This is a direct set of employment. When private intervention or investment will take place in rural area, with set of direct employment, that will create indirect employment as well. So the farmers and the people from rural area will get an alternative to work for those, to work in those warehouses, to work in those cold storage, to work in different set of value chain. So we can, we can give incentive to those, rural population also. So private investments, when that will be done, so that no doubt will bring the structural reform in the rural area. It will boost supply chain management. And the most important point, I'll tell you what will happen. The wastages in agriculture sector will be resolved like anything. Larger revenue loss on the part of the farmers is on account of, wastages. Because most of the farm produce is perishable in nature. So if you do not have good warehousing facilities, so no doubt there are a lot of wastages. There are wastages at the farm level. There are wastages at loading and offloading. There are wastages at the market level. There are wastages at the storage level. So all these things, I'll tell you, can be resolved when there will be more and more of private investment. So the only conclusion I'll tell you, it does not mean that MSP should be eliminated. See, MSP need to be continued. Why? Because considering the uncertainty in agriculture sector, considering the dependence of farmers on monsoon, if such uncertainties are there in agriculture sector, the government need to come out with certain assistance. Because farmers, in case there is no assistance by the government, and if such uncertainties are common, so that will become unbearable for the farmers. And that's why I told you that a good policy in the next 10 years also will not like to eliminate MSP considering the uncertainty involved in agriculture. So what I'm trying to tell you that your approach should be ki MSP bhi rehna chahiye, because that gives temporary relief to the farmers in the midst of uncertainty involved in agriculture sector. But at the same time, slowly and gradually, there need to be reforms in agriculture marketing. Liberalizing the agriculture market will ensure free decisions for the farmers. They can sell their produce anywhere to anyone, depending upon whether that price is affordable or not, and that will give different set of alternative to the farmers to sell their produce. So altogether, in the coming years, MSP need to be continued, but at the same time, efforts need to be taken care of liberalizing the agriculture market as well.